Mr. Francois, beloved Gallo, Governor Banque de France, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, very good morning. First, I'd like to thank Banque de France and my good friend Francois for this opportunity to share my thoughts at this lecture. Both France and Singapore are mature economies, enjoying a high per capita income, but reaching the limits of our growth through increases in factor inputs. If both our countries are to continue growing and enrich the lives of our citizens, it must be through innovation. And if we are to spread the benefits of growth, innovation must be pervasive and not the exclusive preserve of the talented or well-endowed. Innovation is not a zero-sum game. It thrives on diversity, collaboration, and openness. And there's much we can learn from each other, and these are values both Singapore and France subscribe to. France and Singapore have been deepening collaboration in areas such as finance, science, and technology. 2018 was designated as the France-Singapore Year of Innovation. Today, I want to focus on innovation in financial services. Globally, the financial industry is facing slower economic growth, tighter regulation, and keener competition. To overcome these headwinds and contribute to the broader economy, the industry needs to harness technology, foster innovation, and fundamentally transform itself. But how to do this while maintaining the single most important commodity that underpins financial institutions? Trust. As Stephen Covey said, strength lies in differences, not in similarities. This principle is embodied in the French novel The Three Musketeers by Alexandre Dumas. Set in the 17th century, the novel recounts the journey of D'Artagnan, who left for Paris to join the Musketeers of the Guard, and how he overcomes all obstacles. Together with him are three Musketeers with contrasting personalities: Athos, who's intelligent; Porthos, who's adventurous; Aramis, who's true and faithful. But together, they form a well-balanced trio that supports D'Artagnan on his journey. The three musketeers today are finance, technology, and trust, corresponding to Athos, Porthos, and Aramis. And society is D'Artagnan. Can the three modern musketeers work together to support society? Can they complement one another? Can they click? Let me introduce the first musketeer, finance. Like Athos, finance is wise, but can be complicated, and to some extent mysterious and non-accessible to many people. As a result, finance, at least in its traditional form, is losing its appeal. I'm going to be quite harsh in some of my remarks about finance, so please bear with me. We're all in the same industry. Consumers find that banks' processes are too cumbersome to navigate. They are increasingly looking to technology firms for their needs. Some of them are even losing trust in the ability of banks to act in their interest. Bill Gates once said, and many of you know this, people need banking, not banks. It is a reminder that to survive, finance needs to be intuitive, innovative, and customer-centric. This is where the second musketeer comes in, technology. Technology is akin to Porthos, the fearless musketeer, who's eager to try new ways for a better future. In a similar vein, technology presents us opportunities to revitalize finance, the opportunity to enhance customer experience, the opportunity to strengthen risk management, and the opportunity to improve cost efficiency. Let me elaborate on each of these opportunities. First, enhancing customer experience. This has become a critical success factor in many industries, including finance. Why? Basically, technology firms have reshaped the way businesses interact with customers. They have empowered customers and set high bars for customer satisfaction. Whether they're established big tech firms or small fintech startups, they pose a competitive challenge to financial institutions. If I have to name one thing these technology companies can do very well, much better than financial institutions, it would be that they are obsessively customer-centric. Tech firms embed themselves in the customer journey. They use data analytics to deeply understand customer needs. They then provide end-to-end solutions, often customized to individual circumstances. They have agile IT systems, very efficient processes, and a culture that emphasizes speed. Essentially, tech firms think of themselves not as being in any particular industry, but as platforms upon which they provide access to the services that consumers need. Traditional banks tend to be largely product-centric, not customer-centric. The credit card division tries to sell you unsecured credit. The wealth management division tries to sell you mutual funds. The lending division tries to sell you a mortgage. Very often, they don't know what they're doing, what each other is doing. They start with a product and try to persuade the customer why their product is good for them. Many banks do not have a complete, comprehensive picture of their customers. They are weighed down by legacy IT systems and bureaucratic processes. But several banks and financial institutions are stepping up to that challenge. Athos is learning from Porthos. Banks are investing heavily in technology to optimize their operations and to enhance their systems. They are collaborating with technology firms to accelerate the pace of innovation. In short, they are becoming more customer-centric. These banks are using technology to provide customized solutions, complete solutions, and seamless solutions. First, customized solutions to suit the individual needs and characteristics of the customer. Some banks are experimenting with personalized products and services, not just based on what the customer asks for, but by anticipating by what the customer might need. Commonwealth Bank of Australia has a mobile app. It's using behavioral science to provide customers with financial management advice based on their spending patterns and financial goals. Some banks are offering personalized interactions at every customer touchpoint. The Royal Bank of Canada has enabled its customers to pay their bills via their mobile app, via speech and voice recognition. So that's customized solutions. Second, complete solutions that are based on the total picture of the customer. Today's customers are more sophisticated and want holistic solutions. In a survey of 10,000 tech-savvy customers, Accenture found that 80% of them want integrated solutions that address both their financial and non-financial needs. Financial needs, if you think about it, are really driven by non-financial desires. People do not desire a housing loan or a fire insurance policy. People desire a house. The financial needs support that primary non-financial desire. To provide complete, holistic solutions, you need comprehensive customer data, and you need a deep understanding of the customer journey. The customer data that most banks have are simply not sufficient to develop a good understanding of the financial situation or needs of their customers. Customers have multiple relationships with deposits and loans, investments, insurance policies and retirement plans, pension plans, spread across many financial institutions, even government institutions. How many financial institutions advising a customer have a complete picture of the customer's balance sheet, all his assets and liabilities? Now, some banks have started to offer aggregator services, which consolidate financial information such as bank accounts, credit cards, loans, and investments from all the financial institutions serving their customers. This allows financial institutions to provide holistic financial planning. BBVA provides its corporate customers with a consolidated view of all their financial information from about 90 different financial institutions. That's customer data. Next, understanding the customer journey. Some banks have begun to offer their corporate customers complete end-to-end solutions based on a keen understanding of their customers' work processes. United Overseas Bank in Singapore provides its corporate customers an integrated digital platform that enables a customer to generate purchase orders and invoices with just a few clicks of the mouse, streamline its payroll process, and give up-to-date views of its financials, a complete solution. Some banks are positioning themselves as partners with their customers on their life journey, integrating their financial and non-financial needs. DBS Bank in Singapore provides its customers looking to buy a car an online portal that enables them to calculate their budget, survey the available cars, find an affordable one that meets their needs, connect with the seller, get a car loan, and finally purchase a car insurance. Complete solution. Third, banks are using technology to provide seamless solutions. This means resolving bottlenecks and providing customers with a frictionless experience. It means using technology to resolve bottlenecks. Banks such as BBVA, Mitsubishi UFJ, and BNP Paribas are using blockchain technology for syndicated loans. It improves efficiency. Each step of the loan process, from credit underwriting to credit administration, is documented in the distributed ledger, thereby eliminating the need for duplicative back office processing. The loan process is shortened from about 2 weeks to 2 days. This also improves trust. Every record in the distributed ledger has a user code and timestamp. This creates an audit trail, leading to the higher level of trust among the participants. Let me share two initiatives from the Singapore financial sector which show that achieving a seamless customer experience often requires collaboration across institutions and interoperability across systems. Let me repeat, collaboration across institutions and interoperability across systems. The two key ingredients for a digital transaction are one, identity authentication, you need to know who you are, and secure payments. So the Singapore government worked closely with the industry to make the customer experience seamless in these two basic areas. First, seamless identity authentication through what we call MyInfo. MyInfo is a government digital service that enables Singapore residents to authorize third parties to access their personal data residing across different government agencies using APIs or application programming interfaces. The data is not consolidated. The government does not know all the personal data, but is sitting in different places. The customer controls it through APIs, offers a third-party service provider access to that data to complete or consummate a digital transaction. This means that with the consent of the customer, banks can use the MyInfo service for more efficient KYC using government-verified personal data, so-called golden source of information. So for instance, today, I can open a bank account or obtain a credit card in Singapore online, in real time, instantly, when I give consent to my bank to access my data through MyInfo and verify who I am, provided I have no red flags for suspicion. Customers do not need to go through the tedious process of filling up forms, providing hard copy documents to banks for verification, and they certainly don't need to go to the bank branch. Banks benefit from higher productivity and better risk management. The second initiative, secure and seamless payments through PayNow, what we call PayNow. Now, PayNow was jointly developed by the MAS, working with the banking industry. It enables individuals and businesses to transfer funds using just the personal ID number or mobile phone number or unique entity number of their recipients. It operates 24 by 7, and funds can be transferred directly from one bank account to another in real time. I can now send money to my friend in just 3 clicks on my mobile phone. All I need to know is his mobile number, which is on my contacts list. Business users of PayNow can generate a QR code containing their unique entity number. This means I can now pay my utilities provider, my telephone company, or my plumber by simply scanning their QR code using my smartphone and keying in the amount to be transferred. It goes directly to his bank account. Let me now move on to the second way in which technology can benefit finance, strengthening risk management. Risk management and compliance have become major cost drivers in financial institutions since the global financial crisis. Processes have become slower and more cumbersome. The answer does not lie in lowering regulatory requirements or risk management standards. And we know from 2008 what that can lead to. Instead, this is a challenge. Financial institutions should learn to harness technology to make risk management and compliance more efficient, more effective, and cheaper. And technology can improve the efficiency of risk management. JP Morgan is using machine learning to review loan contracts. This reduces the review time to review these loan contracts from 360,000 man hours to seconds. It also minimizes human errors. OCBC Bank in Singapore is using machine learning to monitor customer transactions real time and across multiple channels. This allows the bank to identify fraudulent fund transfers and take more timely actions to recover the funds. Technology can make risk management less passive and more predictive by harnessing the information value of data. Ping An Insurance from China has developed a system that detects whether a banking customer is lying about the reason for borrowing money. It is based on subtle changes in the customer's facial expressions, with the analytical algorithm based on 30,000 videos of real lending cases. Now, I'm not familiar with this technology and I'm not watching for it, but according to Ping An, this has helped to reduce credit losses by 60%. BlackRock and Rhodium are using data analytics to assess the effects or risks of climate change to assets such as mortgage-backed securities under different scenarios. So this is predictive risk management. And we have not tapped on the full potential of some of the new technologies that are emerging. Research by IBM has found that quantum computing algorithms can compute the risk of an investment portfolio near real time. And imagine if that can be piped onto your mobile phone. You know your portfolio values in real time every day. This is a significant reduction from the present Monte Carlo simulation approach, which can take days. The third big opportunity that technology offers finance is improving cost efficiency. This is particularly relevant for banks, who are saddled with the high costs of maintaining extensive branch networks and deterred from entering new markets or reaching underserved segments of the population because the cost of setting up branches is too high. Technology is changing this in two ways. First, the use of digital platforms to quickly and cheaply acquire customers. The ubiquity of the internet, combined with the proliferation of the smartphone, has helped to slash the cost of acquiring a customer. According to research by Oliver Wyman, it costs about $30 to acquire an online banking customer, compared to $150 using offline channels. Basically, the smartphone is replacing the bank branch. Non-bank players have led the way in digital banking. In the United Kingdom, we have seen a proliferation of so-called neobanks, basically non-bank startups who have obtained licenses to do banking business but without physical branches. Starling has opened 520,000 personal accounts, adding 30 since getting a banking license in 2016. Monzo has opened 1.6 million accounts, adding 30,000 accounts each week. Monzo's customers can connect their accounts to 600 different apps and services and create rules to integrate banking into their daily lives. For example, users can create a rule that automatically logs calories to the health app on their mobile phone whenever they purchase coffee. Banks can also play this game, and more of them, I'm happy to note, are doing this. DBS Bank in Singapore launched a digibank in India 2 years ago, has already garnered 2.5 million customers. Digibank is using artificial intelligence to learn customers' spending habits and will prompt them if they are overspending, or provide relevant marketing offers such as coffee vouchers if you're a caffeine lover. Maybe we should combine the DBS Bank app and the Monzo app to achieve a more balanced intake of coffee. United Overseas Bank from Singapore has just launched in Thailand a digital-only bank, TMRW, pronounced tomorrow, aimed at millennials in particular. It comes complete with an engagement lab using behavioral insights to study the customer's banking habits and needs. Tomorrow's mobile app features a game designed to encourage the customers to save more. Gamification is a powerful tool, as the tech firms have demonstrated, to subtly nudge and influence customers to do the right thing. In Hong Kong, the regulator has given out licenses to 8 virtual banks to acquire and deliver banking services through the internet. The take-up numbers are interesting. They indicate the competition that's emerging in the space of digital banking. Out of the 8 virtual banks, 5 are non-banks, but 3 are backed by banks. But the second and potentially more powerful way in which technology is helping to drive down the cost of financial intermediation is through partnerships between financial institutions and fintech firms. SocGen is working with TagPay to provide mobile banking in Africa through a cloud-based platform that is compatible with any mobile phone. AXA is working with MicroEnsure, another fintech firm, to offer simple and affordable insurance products to customers across Africa and Asia. By helping to reduce customer acquisition cost, these collaborations have helped to serve a larger social purpose, enhancing financial inclusion and expanding opportunity. But there's a lot more we need to do, the financial industry. There are about 1.7 billion adults globally who are unbanked. In the 10 ASEAN countries of Southeast Asia, where I come from, half the adult population is unbanked. This is a shame. The ASEAN countries have a burgeoning middle class, increasingly modern infrastructure if you visit the cities. Yet, so many people there do not have access to a bank account, secure and affordable payments, or insurance protection. Reason: banks and insurers face high cost in reaching out to customers in remote areas. We need to take collaboration between financial institutions and fintech firms to a much broader level, beyond the bilateral partnerships, much broader level, through platforms for innovation and inclusion. This is why the MAS, the ASEAN Bankers Association, and the World Bank's International Finance Corporation, IFC, have teamed up to establish the ASEAN Financial Innovation Network, or AFIN for short. AFIN aims to bring banks and fintech firms from across the world to develop innovative solutions to penetrate hard-to-reach markets in a cost-efficient way. Last year, AFIN launched the API Exchange, the world's first cross-border open architecture platform to enhance financial inclusion. The API Exchange is a cloud-based platform that does two things. It is first a marketplace, enabling financial institutions to go on the platform and discover and connect the fintech partners through APIs on a globally curated platform. You put out a problem statement and you wait for solutions to come. It also provides a sandbox environment for financial institutions and the fintech firms after they've connected to then design and test cross-border solutions. And the regulator is an observer of the sandbox. I have spoken so far of how the two musketeers, finance and technology, can and must come together to bring value and convenience to customers. But for consumers to be part of this ecosystem, there needs to be trust, the third musketeer. Trust is similar to Aramis, the third musketeer, who is faithful and values friendship. Trust is a key attribute for the success of a financial ecosystem. It is a shared responsibility among all the actors in the ecosystem. Banks, in particular, must be trustworthy so that customers have faith that their money and their data are safe with them. As finance adopts more technology, it must pay close attention to three risks so as to maintain the trust of consumers. First, cyber risk. As more financial services move online and collaboration among banks and technology companies becomes more pervasive, a growing risk that financial institutions are facing is in cyberspace. The frequency, scale, and complexity of cyber attacks are mounting. Attackers can carry out sophisticated and prolonged attacks that can be difficult to identify and defend against. According to a study by FireEye, the median time it takes to detect a cyber intrusion is 78 days. We need to do something. First, we need some common risk management standards in cyber defense. The risk management systems, cyber risk management systems in financial institutions, and regulatory and supervisory frameworks for cyber resilience are uneven and still in an evolutionary stage. There is no international equivalent of the Basel Capital Accord in cyber risk management. But given the clear and present danger that cyber risk poses in Singapore, MAS has put in place a mix of mandatory requirements and best practice guidelines for cyber risk management. Now, given their role as repositories of public monies and conduits for payments, banks in particular must meet higher cybersecurity standards. MAS expects banks to limit unscheduled system downtime of their critical IT systems to no more than 4 hours in a whole year. Conduct due diligence on third-party service providers' controls to safeguard customer information. This is the weakest link in the system. And they must report all significant cyber incidents to the MAS within 1 hour. But cyber risk management should go beyond banks. The connectedness among the participants in the financial systems means that a cyber attack on one party can potentially escalate into a more systemic problem. So we need to level up the cyber resilience of all financial institutions. Not necessarily to the level of banks, but at least to a basic level, what we call cyber hygiene, basic cyber hygiene. Research has shown that the majority of cyber crimes or cyber incidents can be avoided if some simple cyber hygiene practices are adopted. So very soon, in a couple of weeks, MAS will issue a set of mandatory requirements on cyber hygiene that will apply to all financial institutions in Singapore. They include basic things like securing your administrative accounts, controlling network access at the perimeter, installing security patches promptly, installing antivirus software on their systems, and implementing multi-factor authentication for users who access customer information over the internet. In short, if we don't get cybersecurity right, financial institutions will be constrained in how much they can leverage on technology. The second area financial institutions must address to ensure customer confidence is information security risk. Information security is not the same as cybersecurity. Information security is focused on protecting data, while cybersecurity is focused on protecting systems. They are, however, closely related. Data leaks can occur when a system is not properly secured. But even when a system is properly secured, data leaks can occur. In the financial system or ecosystem, information security risk is growing for two reasons. One, more and more data are becoming digitized. The International Data Corporation has estimated that digital data will increase fivefold from 2018 to 2025. Two, as banks begin to collaborate with fintech and big tech players, customer data will be that was traditionally within the inner sanctum of banks will increasingly be shared with third-party service providers. So banks have to exercise care for the data they hold, as well as those that they have shared with third parties. This means understanding at a granular level the data that are held, processed, and shared. Assessing the criticality and sensitivity of all data sets. Putting in place targeted measures to safeguard the data. And taking swift recovery measures in the event of a data breach. This is important because apart from personal health data, people regard their personal financial data as most sensitive. Financial institutions have a particular responsibility to safeguard this data if people are to trust technology and innovation. The third area to watch closely is risk from the misuse of data analytics and artificial intelligence. Data analytics and artificial intelligence, huge potential. They can help to uncover patterns which human beings are unaware of. They can provide insights that we could not have gained from traditional analytical tools. But unless there is public trust that data analytics and artificial intelligence will be used responsibly, financial institutions will not get the social license that they need to apply these technologies widely. To gain this trust, we must address four areas in data analytics and artificial intelligence. One, privacy of data. How do we safeguard the confidentiality of personal data? Two, explainability of the results of data analytics. How do we minimize the black box syndrome? Three, accountability for the decisions. How can we hold humans ultimately responsible for decisions that are made by self-learning algorithms and machines? Four, acceptability of the outcomes. How do we minimize unconscious bias in data analytics? Social exclusion and ethically unacceptable consequences that may come from machine learning. So the MAS has co-created with the financial industry in Singapore a set of preliminary principles to guide the responsible use of data analytics and artificial intelligence in financial services. The principles are centered on four pillars: fairness, ethics, accountability, and transparency. Hence the shorthand name FEAT, FEAT principles. They're not prescriptive, but they represent an industry consensus that individual financial institutions take reference from when they formulate their own data governance policies and practices, including in relation to artificial intelligence use. We believe the FEAT principles will help to promote public confidence and trust in the use of data analytics and artificial intelligence in our financial sector. Let me conclude. Technology and finance must come together, and they must do so in a manner that maintains trust. Finance, technology, and trust are like the three musketeers of old. Like Athos, finance allocates resources to those who need it. Like Porthos, Technology represents the aspiration for finance to innovate. And like Aramis, trust engenders confidence in finance. The motto of the Three Musketeers is tous pour un, un pour tous. Forgive my French. One for all for one. If finance, technology, and trust can do the same, we can have innovation and dynamism with safety and stability. And we can benefit not only the financial industry, but society at large. We can raise productivity, expand opportunity, and enrich the lives of our people. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, dear Ravi, it was, as expected, fascinating. And so I will not elaborate on what you said. Perhaps to sum up, you made two invitations to us. The first one is an invitation to reread Les Trois Mousquetaires, the Three Musketeers, and thinking about the various characters. Is Athos Finance, Porthos Tech, and Aramis Trust? I thought about it, but there is food for thought here. And second, more seriously, you invited us to a journey. It's a journey through the world to Asia and Singapore, and obviously you are very innovative, congratulations. And it's a journey through time. And clearly, we must undertake this journey without any doubt. We are undertaking this journey, but your message was a really positive one. We can undertake this journey with confidence and probably more than confidence, hope. And you gave many reasons for hope. So I will stop here and give the floor to the audience for questions. I would have some too, but please start with the audience. The first question is always the most sensitive one. Please, you have the microphone next, and if you can only introduce yourself, Ravi Menon.
Good morning, my name is Lubna Sabil, I work in the financial department of the bank. I had a question about the trust part of your very interesting presentation. How to make sure that the use of our of client data, you said nudge them to do the right, to take the right financial decision, won't be actually a way to nudge people to do what the financial sector wants us to do. How do you make sure that people trust that their free will still be taken into account? Because this is what we are seeing in the tech industry with the, for instance, a lot of data that is used to nudge people to sell more and not to let them do what they want to do.
Yeah, this is working. No, it's a very good question. It's a question we're all grappling with, and it goes beyond regulators and financial services. Basically, we need data governance policies and practices at the national, and hopefully one day at the international level, because this is not only for central banks or regulators to decide. And I think in many ways, Europe is quite advanced with this by introducing the idea of responsible use of data, which is something that we have learned from and applied through the FEET principles. I think the citizen or the owner, the consumer, must have the right to know how the data is being used. This is a very important principle. And then the challenge lies in how to translate this principle into practice. The problem we have is that today, when you buy an app or when you subscribe to a service, you're given, you know, on your mobile phone screen 30 pages of things to read and understand, terms and conditions, and then they'll ask you, have you read the terms and conditions? You're in a hurry, you just click agree. Because firstly, even if you read the 30 pages, you can't understand anything. It's written in legal language. So this is a problem. We have the solution in form, but not in substance. So I think this is where policy should be focused on, how to make this intelligible to the consumer so the consumer knows how the data can be, how the data is being used. Second, there is an asymmetry of power here. If you decide you don't want your data to be used in this manner and you do not subscribe to the service itself doesn't suffer unless large numbers of people do the same. So there must be some idea of what is the socially acceptable use of that data, for what purpose. And this varies from country to country. It reflects, in some sense, cultural preferences. You take, for example, China, where a lot of data is being used for all kinds of social credit scoring. Points are awarded for good behavior, meaning you pay your taxes, you pay utilities on time, and now with cameras, you know, you do not break traffic rules. A complete picture is being formed. And based on that complete picture, a score is being developed and actions are being taken. And there are consequences. Now, people seem to accept that. I can't say this for sure, but there seems to be a general acceptance of that. It will be very hard to imagine that in Singapore, or I would imagine in France. But there may be some things that people don't mind sharing in Singapore that the French might take exception to. So that's a problem. The individual's attitudes towards what data can be used for what purpose seems to vary across cultures and across institutional factors. Another example, Singapore is working on a digital identity, and you need a digital identity a national digital identity to transact. The only other two countries who have this are Estonia and India, which has a biometric-based digital identity. And in Singapore, we are well on our way to doing it. It's easy for us to do because we, today, all of us carry an identity card. And that's thanks to the British when we were a colony under Britain. And there's a communist insurgency for security purposes that was imposed. And it has become socially acceptable to carry an identity card. In countries in Europe and America where such a tradition doesn't exist, to then have a digital ID which captures personal information would be quite hard to achieve. So what I'm explaining is not, I'm not giving an answer, I'm explaining the complexity of the issues here. And even if we solve all this, there's also the question of how do you regulate the outcomes of data analytics and machine learning? So one of the principles we applied in Singapore, we asked the industry, and the industry agreed. Those decisions that you would not make as a human being, if the machine makes that decision, you should not allow it. For instance, if for some reason data analytics statistically finds that when it comes to hiring decisions, there are differences in ethnic background or gender that matter statistically, would you take that into consideration? If the policy is if humans are making that decision, we will disregard ethnicity and gender and go on merit, then that will be applied also on the machine. Even if the machine finds a statistical basis, it should not lead to exclusion. So that's what we are worried about. It should not exclude classes or categories of people just because the algorithm finds a statistical basis for it. But ethically, we think even if there's a statistical basis, we want to ignore. So we will not include that variable, even if it's like a regression. It's a relevant variable, but we exclude it because we don't want that to be part of the decision making. So I think we are all in early days. But if you ask me, I'll come back to what I said at the start. the world needs a proper framework for data governance. And I think in the EU, we are making quite good progress, not completely there. But I think the sooner we have this, the better, because otherwise, you will have the pitfalls of technology without harnessing the benefits.
I couldn't agree more on data protection and international cooperation. And it was interesting to learn, by the way, Ravi, that Singapore identity card and culture is due to British law. When you know the debate about Britain still at present about identity card, but Stefan Buznau, who is chairman of Euronext. Use the mic in your... I know your voice is very powerful, but...
thank you very much for your enlightening comments. You come from Singapore, which is sort of a neutral location, located in Asia with a strong European culture, legacy, etc. When you look at the world you have described, what is your intimate personal view as to who will be the winners and the losers of this new environment? Where will be the location in the planet where people will be solution takers, and where will people be solution makers? How this new environment will drive a shift of power influence, who will be in the driving seat and who will be in the passenger seat in this new environment, and how do you see shift? Yeah, just your gut feeling about is the game over, or are there some fundamental seeds for changing the dynamic of the games between Europe, the US, and Asia?
I think if you look at it purely from various technologies, I think there are many competing centers. I don't think any particular center is looking stronger than others. If you look at most surveys and indicators, people often cite Silicon Valley, London, the obvious one. Singapore is increasingly making the rankings. Israel is strong, especially in cybersecurity. So if you look at various areas, there are various centers of excellence. China, of course, is a hotbed of innovation across the board. And I think this is good competition. And as I said, innovation is not zero sum. It builds on one another. I think innovation doesn't respect national boundaries. Lots of collaborations are taking place, mostly because of the multinational nature of corporations. Many European financial institutions have innovation labs in Singapore where they experiment in testbed because it's a conducive environment. But the innovation is not trapped in Singapore. It's taken back to where it's deployed, either in the home country in Europe or sometimes in other similar markets, emerging markets. So I think I see a lot of such collaboration. I don't want to sound too hopeful about this. Now when it comes to big data and artificial intelligence, there is, I think, very keen competition, because unlike many of the other technologies which are specific and vertical, data analytics and artificial intelligence is quite pervasive. It can cover all kinds of areas. And here, I think, the institutional structures of societies, I mentioned the cultural attitudes and so on, matter a great deal. If you ask yourselves, why is it that big tech has emerged primarily in the United States and China, not in other parts of Asia, not in Japan, not in Korea, not in Europe? You don't have any major big tech player. I think it's partly because of the, a more laissez-faire attitude towards data agglomeration, what some of us might criticize as data monopolization, and a certain ambiguity in the rights to data. For artificial intelligence, for instance,
if you want to train the algorithm to work close enough to the human brain, it needs to process large amounts of data, large amounts. Small countries like Singapore, if you only depend on our population base, you can't do that. You need continental-sized databases, access to that data. And when I mentioned Ping An, it's like going through 30,000 video recordings of lending decisions and studying the facial patterns. So China does this very well. And I think in many ways, China is well positioned for it. Like I said, the society seems to have an acceptance for data aggregation and data sharing on that scale and drawing insights from that. Will it always be the case? I don't know. There are some people who are not happy with some of the consequences, so it's still evolving. The United States, I think, has some of the very advanced primary capabilities in data analytics and artificial intelligence, and IBM and all those examples. But it's a lot more difficult in the US to achieve that kind of mass accumulation of data, with the exception of course, Facebook and Amazon and others. So I think it's a very interesting landscape. It's not clear who will emerge as the leading player in artificial intelligence and data analytics. But I think for long-term sustainability, what I call a social license, public acceptance of these things, you need to have strong governance and trust mechanisms. And that, I think, is important, because sooner or later, people will start getting very uneasy about these things. And if you want to give people confidence, you must give them confidence that this is well-governed, and this is for the public good, and individuals are taken care of. If those governance principles are well in place, then I think the technology will have greater acceptance. So from that perspective, I'm not even sure if the US and China are necessarily ahead, but they may be in terms of the pure technological capabilities they have in these areas.
Next question. I look perhaps at the back here. Then we will come back to the floor.
Thank you, Jean Boissineau from the Banque de France. You mentioned the key role of sector and system-wide collaboration in delivering the potential of digitalization. Can you elaborate on the Singaporean experience in that sector-wide collaboration, and what role does institutions like MAS and policymakers can have in fostering such collaboration?
Yes. Thanks for the opportunity, because I think it's a good follow-up to what I've said earlier. I'm a little uneasy about data monopolies that are closed systems. That means if you're not part of that system, you can't participate. And that system is not interoperable. So if you're on the Alibaba platform, you can't. And if you have Alipay as your payment device, you can only pay to another person who also has Alipay. So it forces people to enter that closed ecosystem. And then you have Tencent and WeChat Pay. So if you're on WeChat, you pay to another person on WeChat. And the system works by consolidating all their data in one place. And I think that's not a very good model. I think we need, what I said earlier, collaboration across institutions and interoperability of systems. But this doesn't happen naturally, unfortunately, because the players are competitive. They don't want to make it interoperable. So when we started the electronic payments journey in Singapore, each bank started introducing their own wallets and apps. But you can only pay seamlessly if the other person has the same bank. And that doesn't make sense. So if I want to send money to Francois and my bank account is a DBS Singapore, he also must have a DBS account, which is absurd. So we then had to step in and say, you have, for the benefit of the customer, this is a social purpose. You have to make your systems interoperable. Regulators have their way of, you know, getting their way. But the banks saw them. They couldn't argue against it. And I'm very happy that they came together and they built a system where they said, we don't need to understand each other's bank account numbers. What everyone has is a mobile number. we will create a central addressing scheme. This is a central industry utility underpinning the payment system, where everyone then links their bank account number to a mobile number. In which case, then I can send money to Francois if I only know his mobile number, which I would have on my contacts list. And then we said, you have to make the process seamless so that people don't get confused on the methods. So we sat down and banged our heads and agreed, okay, it has to be fast and safe. Three clicks, key in the amount, key in the mobile number, you drag down from your contacts. There should be a confirmation because, you know, before you send the money, one last check. And then when you have checked it, you send and the money goes. So then we had to agree among ourselves, working with the banks, on user protection guidelines. What if there's a mistake? Who is liable? What is the liability limit for the bank? What are the responsibilities of the consumer? If you don't take care of your password, then you are liable. But if you have, you know, taken care of your password and followed basic cyber hygiene, then some of the liabilities of the bank. So you have to, and these things have to be settled through a process of dialogue and discussion and common agreement, and then you set guidelines and principles. So now PayNow is taking off quite well. People send money to each other. They don't need to know which bank they are on. Systems are interoperable. So it's one thing to say, let 100 flowers bloom in the name of innovation, but you must create a garden. The flowers must blend together and create a garden. Then it's pleasing to the eye. It's all over the place, different colors. They don't match. That is not socially purposeful. So you need that flexibility and latitude, give players the space to innovate, come up with solutions, but keep insisting on interoperability. That's very important. And in payment space, that's very important. And now we're trying to do it cross-border. See if we can do the same thing cross-border with interoperability of systems.
This analogy of the flowers and the garden is really nice, Ravi. And we are supposed to be the gardeners, I guess. But Mark, you had a question.
Yes, thank you very much for your lecture today. My name is Mark Andries. I work at the ACPR. If I remember correctly, D'Artagnan was a cadet in the military, so meaning he had to learn from the Three Musketeers. What about educating the customer today about finance and technology? There are a lot of issues about that, and what does the mass do about it?
Yeah, it's an excellent question. So now we are increasingly spending more and more effort in educating consumers about good cyber practices and technology practices. In schools, I don't know how it is here, when I was growing up, we were taught how to cross a road, look right, left, and then right again. We weren't taught how to brush our teeth, the strokes. This is in elementary school, right? Kindergarten, they would take the children out and the teachers would teach them how to brush. Basic hygiene is taught. Increasingly in our curriculum in schools, we need to introduce cyber hygiene. Never share your password. Have strong passwords. Put antivirus on your phone. Patch updates when they come. Make the patch updates immediately to strengthen defenses. There are about 10 or 12, you know, basic things that people should take care of. One of the things we are very concerned about is that now people are getting email messages, supposedly from some authoritative source, with a link that tells you that there is something wrong with your account. Please go to this link and rectify it. Once they click on that link, you get into a malware gets infected. There are also fake websites that look like bank websites and invite you in. This is called phishing, and then you get entrapped. I'm told that some of the banks have received emails, supposedly from me, asking the bank for data. Of course, the banks know very well that the managing director of the MAS is not going to send them an email asking for data, so that's not a very clever trick.
But there are a whole lot of these, and unfortunately, some people fall prey to them. So we are stepping up education through the schools. I don't think it's good enough, but it's starting cyber wellness and awareness. And then to reinforce this at the point, it needs to be continuous. It can't be something you learn in school, and then when it comes to opening an account, doing a digital transaction, then you don't apply. So it needs to be continually reminded at those points. So with electronic payments, we are now stepping up the education part of this. And I think this needs to be quite widespread, because otherwise you're going to get quite a few lapses and mistakes and people suffering as a result.
Next question. I'll go here.
Thank you very much for your lecture. I'm Eric. I'm living in Singapore for 17 years, an investor and board member in FinTech in France and one in Singapore. Talking about the relationship between France and Singapore, do you think that one day we could imagine to have a financial passport between the two countries for financial institutions to, you know, in the same way that you have it in the European Union?
Financial passport meaning
like to become member of the Eurozone?
Well, I think the more interesting agreements that we have, and Francois mentioned this earlier, is the FinTech Cooperation Agreement, where less well-known FinTech players in France or in Singapore can, you know, go into each other's markets with some degree of confidence and comfort, and the regulators have some degree of comfort. Our major banks and insurance companies, they know each other very well. They have operations in each other's countries, especially the French insurers and banks are heavily represented in Singapore. It's not a complicated relationship. I think if it's a less well-known French fintech player or a new player that wants to come to Singapore, it's not like dealing with BNP or with AXA. We would need some comfort. And I think the FinTech Cooperation Agreement gives that kind of confidence. And likewise, if a Singapore FinTech player wants to come and do something here, typically the regulator's response is, what's your track record and all that. By definition, some of them don't have a track record. So some comfort, mutual comfort from regulatory exchanges helps. I think that's a fruitful area. The other areas that it's not so much passporting, but data connectivity. How can we have cheaper cross-border payments between France and Singapore, for instance? This is something we are working with Canada on, using blockchain. We also have a project with Thailand, which involves linking up the payment systems in both countries. So they're on the same common standard, and Thailand also has a similar features that I just described, where the bank account number is linked to the mobile number. There's large migrant workforce and tourism flows between Thailand and Singapore. So Governor Virathai and I discussed and said, you know, in 2 years' time, 1 year has already passed, I should be able to send money to him through his mobile number in Singapore dollars. He will receive it in Thai baht in his account instantaneously. So one day I hope to do that with Francois. We can send each other money just using the mobile number. So you have to define what is a problem you want to solve. And that would be a wonderful thing to do, because there's lots of business relationships where money flows are involved. But there's a lot of hard work behind that, because you have to link up the systems, and the systems must be interoperable. I mentioned systems interoperability within the domestic context, but we need to explore more bilateral. I think it will be many, many years before we have a global solution, which would be ideal, but knowing these things, this will take forever. But if like-minded parties can come together and try to link up their systems, payment systems, learn from the experience, it will be a huge benefit, and then we can slowly bring in other parties. So we are talking to some others who might be interested in doing some of these, on an experimental basis. It may not work, but I think it is worth experimenting because you learn from that experience and can do better the next time.
We will stop at 10:30 in about 10 minutes, so we still have time for two or three questions, and I will possibly have one, starting with yours.
Thank you. I'm Mathieu Eloin, the Chief Digital Officer of BPI France. I have a question if you have any KPIs to monitor really the progress of innovation inside the Singapore ecosystems in terms of open banking, in terms of collaboration between banks and fintechs, or whatever, which measure the success of all that you set up in place in terms of innovative framework for the ecosystem?
So, very good question. I must say that we don't have an elaborate set of KPIs. In the innovation space or research and development in general, it's a very fine balance to strike between having targets, KPIs, and outcomes. Because if you don't measure these things, you end up doing a lot of things that are irrelevant or wrong or too expensive. But if you're too tight about it, that itself detracts from the experimental nature of many of these things. So I think some of the tangible ones, we count the number of innovation labs, we count the number of people, jobs gained in fintech, and it has been every year we got about 1,000 jobs, new jobs in fintech area, which is good because it creates opportunities for people. We measure VC funding and private equity funding for fintech projects. That's been increasing. Then we look at a few slightly less quantitative things, like some of the examples I cited, banks using technology to detect suspicious transactions. So we look at a few project examples to see if they are working well, because some of them we also help to fund. We have some financial grant schemes for promising experiments. And then the large industry projects, payments is one of them, which we also funded extensively. And there we look at the pickup in the payment, in the number of electronic usage. We have set a target. By 2025, we want to eliminate checks completely in Singapore, zero checks, because there's no reason why you need to send a check. It can be done electronically. We will not eliminate cash. I know Sweden is well on its way, but I think for many elderly people and for children, I'm not sure I will give my mobile phone to my primary school child to send money around. So I think cash has some limited usage, but maybe 10% cash usage or 5% cash usage in the economy is about right. So we have set targets to bring down cash usage. Cash imposes a heavy economic cost on countries. We don't seem to know it, but actually the cost of transportation, security, printing, and so on is not trivial. Checks are worse. In Singapore, I don't know what it's in France like, but in Singapore, it takes $1.50, Singapore cents, which is about one US dollar, to send a check, to process a check. People don't pay for it. Banks bear the cost. Now we are passing the cost on. So I think these are some of the KPIs to eliminate check usage, for instance, because that will be we know it's a saving for the economy through electronic payments.
The cost of processing a check for us is at least this level, but I don't know the precise figure. What are the questions left in the audience, please? I just check if there is still another one. Can I suggest we put your two questions together and then you give a common answer?
Just have a very short question, Raphaël François Poncet, Baker McKenzie. Coming back to the global players that you have mentioned in the future, you have not mentioned Russia and especially which have both banks and technologies, and just wanted to have your opinion on this.
Sana Orish from Markets Directorate. In a few words, could you give us your feedback on your recently launched experience, regulatory sandbox, and with the fast progress of artificial intelligence and big data, and the emergence of new players like fintech, deep tech, insurtech, what would be the new role of central banks and regulators in the next decade? Thank you.
You had two questions, I thought. The first one was to ask about progress of
sandbox.
Sandbox, okay. Okay. I'm no expert on Russia. Of course, they have a long tradition of science and technology, and they're also doing interesting things. So I think beyond that, I don't have any special insight to offer. Generally, our approach has not been to look at countries. It's to look at promising players, and they are everywhere. You can find some of the most relevant and innovative solutions coming out of Bangkok, Jakarta, Bangalore, many emerging economies. And let's not forget the cradle or founding place of fintech is Kenya, M-Pesa, the payment system using the mobile phone. So I think when it comes to innovation, they're spread all over the world. And I'm not saying this to be politically correct. It is the case. It is spread because there are creative entrepreneurial people everywhere. Now, some countries have bigger, stronger capabilities, China, Russia, United States. But I think when you look for solutions, we rather look at players in all over the world. The experience with the sandbox, yes, has been quite promising so far. So we have, you know, lots and lots of applications into the sandbox. I can't recall the numbers offhand. One of the best KPI for us is when they apply to say, we have this new product, new solution, we want to put in the sandbox. It turns out that actually we said, actually, you don't need a sandbox. You can go ahead and do it because it's not a regulated activity. So they're pleasantly surprised. So many people think that almost anything they want to do is regulated by the MAS in some way. And then they find out, no, this is not a regulated entity. If you do this, then you cross the boundary, then you must get a license. At that point, you come into the sandbox. Then there are others who apply to test solutions. So I think we've had quite a few interesting examples. Many of them are in the insurance space rather than in the banking space. It was quite interesting. And many of them are in the financial advisory space using artificial intelligence to give financial advice, for instance. There was one very interesting project where they tried to solve, and it came from the founder. She's a young lady whose mother was diagnosed with cancer. She thought she had sufficient health insurance coverage. When she went through her insurance policies, realized it was not covered. And she said, this is a problem many of us have. We have many insurance policies, but we actually don't understand them very well. And so she developed a technology, optical OCR, optical character recognition. All you need to do is to put all your insurance policies on the table, scan them, and it goes back to her firm, her startup, her fintech startup, and they use character recognition to analyze and understand the policies and then to distill and summarize what they cover, what they do, where your gaps are. And then if you are interested, then you can have the option of seeking financial advice. Now that's a regulated activity. This technology is untested. What if it gives a wrong analysis? Customers get hurt. So we said, okay, you better go into the sandbox, limit to 300 customers, put out a disclaimer that if the customer gets wrong information, that is part of an experiment, so the customer knows this is part of an experiment. So these are ways in which you draw boundaries, limit the damage if something goes wrong, because sometimes these experiments don't work. There's full disclosure. And then let them do it. Let them do it. And then find if the technology works. If the success rate is good,
then they come out of the sandbox, then they apply for a license. So I think that experience has been quite good. The other question was on, the second one was
On the new role of central banks and regulators.
Oh, the, yes.
For the
in
next
2 minutes,
decade.
Yeah. Well, that I think I've covered quite a bit in my remarks, and it's there is no question that financial institutions are going to have to adopt and harness new technologies. The way in which regulation has to adapt I would just give one short answer to that. Increasingly, I think education will be, regulation will be on an activity basis, not on an entity basis. Francois mentioned this earlier. Same activity, same rules. But you have to break down the value chain of activities. So today, most of our regulators, I think this is true of all jurisdictions, we have a Banking Act, we have an Insurance Act, we have a Securities and Futures Act. It's by broad industry categories. But today's financial services are provided by players who don't fall into each of these. Now, if you regulate every of these entities like a bank, they will die because they cannot meet Basel III capital requirements and liquidity requirements. And they don't need to if they're not taking a deposit. But they're doing part of banking business. They're doing part of payments business. They're doing some part of insurance business, but not doing the underwriting. Or they're doing the underwriting, but they're not doing the distribution and sales. In other words, the value chain of financial services is being spliced into specific activities. Players who are good in those activities, who have the right technology for those activities, are doing them. So how do you deal with them? You cannot not regulate them because that's not safe. But if you regulate them in the traditional way, you will overburden them. So you have to do activity-based. And that's what we did with the Payments Act, which is coming out end of this year, just passed in Parliament earlier this year. We broke up the payments value chain into six parts. Some of them do merchant acquisition. Some of them do fund, they store the float on the e-wallet. Some of them do not touch the money, but they are a transmitter. Some of them authorize. There are different activities they do. They pose different kinds of risks. So we went to understand each of those risks separately and tailored regulations to meet each of them so that each of them will be subject to regulations that are only relevant to their particular activity. So it's like a checkbox. You know, you do three out of six things, you're regulated for those three things, not for the full six things. So I think increasingly we need to move towards activity-based. We're thinking of a deposit-taking act because banking is just too broad. Maybe it should be deposit-taking. Those who are doing the lending business, that's a different activity. Sometimes the two activities don't go together. This is going to be hugely challenging because you have to rethink a lot of the way we regulate. We have to rethink legislation, rules, and so on. But I think that is the challenge for regulators. And I think if we follow that simple principle of activity, same activity, same regulation, activity-based regulation, I think we will get the benefits of both right-sizing regulation, fostering innovation, at the same time keeping the system safe and protecting consumers. Thank you.
Ravi, I allow myself, as the master of ceremony, a last question or comment, you will decide, about China and linked to your third musketeer, which is trust. Because we could possibly have two quite different ecosystems. The first one, let's say, in Europe and in the US, where there is increasing distrust from citizens and so increasing data protection rules. And the other one in China, where there is no issue of trust, and we can discuss if it is for cultural or political reasons. This is not my topic. Very low data protection. If it is the case, we already have two quite different ecosystems. So we have an issue of level playing field. And we all know that we have an issue of confidence between these two ecosystems. How to deal with this issue? You might choose to take this as a personal comment from me or as a question. And for the purpose of time, you are completely free.
Yeah, it's, well, one principle we will subscribe to is that, okay, I'll mention two things. These are excellent, this is an excellent comment because
is something we're also grappling with. There is a danger, or there is a trend towards a bifurcation in the world, in the technology sphere. China, as you put it, and then the West. I think my own view is that in terms of governance principles, it's Singapore will be closer to I think, the thinking in the West about data protection. We would probably not make it too onerous or prescriptive. So our own version of GDPR is not quite as prescriptive as GDPR. Now, the issue is, if these players carry out regulated activities, then we should be technology neutral and bring them into our ambit. So we welcome many of the big tech Chinese players to come to Singapore, but we make it very clear, if you are taking customer monies above, you know, the size of the wallet, we put a limit, $5,000. If you're taking more than that, you are in deposit-taking business, and you will be subject to those businesses. In China, Alibaba provides mutual funds. I think if they came to any other jurisdiction, they would need to get a license to provide mutual funds. And there are a lot of requirements in place for that under the Securities and Futures Act in Singapore. So I think we can, and we will also insist on interoperability. One of the things where we differ from Europe in open banking, in UK has open banking, in Europe you have PSD2 and GDPR, where you can authorize any third-party service provider to access your bank and insurance accounts with customer consent. We are not sure we will go that far because it is an uneven playing field. If Amazon or Facebook or Alibaba or Tencent or PayPal are authorized by customer to gain access to the customer's bank accounts in Bank Paribas, BNP Paribas, SocGen, his insurance policies in AXA and so on, and they use their superior data analytics, they are going to be very formidable. Now, AXA, BNP Paribas and others may have very good data engines too, but is it reciprocal? Can they have access to the e-commerce players' data? Can they have access to Amazon's customer data? It has to be two-way. So, which is why we are less ambitious on that front. We are going to have some form of open banking, but we will limit it to within financial institutions, because then we can insist on reciprocity. If the bank is obliged to provide deposit information, then the insurance company is obliged to provide the policyholder's information. It's a level playing field. Now, if an e-commerce player wants to come in, then the bank has a right to ask the customer to ask for e-commerce transactions data. Then you're on a level playing field. So I think that's one way in which we can probably manage the system, because at the core of it, we still want to make sure that the financial system is sound and strong and not hollowed out. But we're not going to be protecting them indefinitely.
Thank you very much, Ravi, for all your answers, for your speech, for being here. So you will now visit Le Lab. I don't know if you are aware that in the geography of Paris, Le Lab is very close to Le Louvre. And Le Louvre is a very famous museum, obviously, but it also used to be the King's Castle, and which is probably less known by you. Le Louvre was the start of the real journey of the Three Musketeers. So we wish you a good journey to Le Lab, and we wish to all of us a good journey through this innovative world you promised us. Thank you very much.